And joining us now on the line from Washington, D.C., Patrick Cronin, Senior Director of the Asia-Pacific Security Program at the Center for a New American Security. And Patrick, as I welcome you back to the program, I want to remind everybody that you were actually on this program back in March when you mentioned that the disagreement over the rules of the road in the South China Sea would surely lead to another dispute. And a month later, China was aggressively reasserting itself in the region. And I want to just take a moment here to read an excerpt from the Wall Street Journal to get our viewers up to scratch on what's been going on. Here we go. Chinese and Philippine naval ships faced off for nearly a week over eight Chinese fishing boats operating off a shoal in the South China Sea claimed by both countries. The conflict was a mere 124 nautical miles from the Philippines and occurred well within Manila's exclusive economic zone, EEZ. The Philippines moved forcefully in the first stages of the confrontation, sending its largest warship to intercept the ships last week. Two Chinese maritime surveillance ships arrived, however, blocking the Philippine vessel and protecting the fishing ships. A standoff ensued, and China sent in another ship. Both sides started urgent diplomatic negotiations. But while top Philippine diplomats asserted that the two countries would not go to war over Scarborough, Philippine politicians were calling for an international diplomatic offensive to pressure Beijing into accepting widely recognized EEZ definitions. That Beijing came out on top will embolden China's rogue fishermen and further worry smaller states who feel they have no recourse against China's demands in similar disputes. So tell us, Patrick, how did this thing eventually get itself resolved?
The Philippine government decided to de-escalate, and they took a series of steps over the last 2 months to try to de-escalate. China reciprocated once or twice for very short-term tactical reasons. For instance, when Philippine President Aquino came to Washington, D.C. for high-level consultations and a summit meeting, the Chinese sent a softer message. As soon as President Aquino got on an airplane, however, the Chinese ramped up their civilian law enforcement coverage around Scarborough Shoal. They continue to support tremendous fishing activity, Chinese fishing activity in a zone that they banned to fishing. And they had their PLA Navy hovering within 100 miles on a station 24 hours a day, ready to come over the horizon if necessary. So the Philippines eventually backed down. There's been no resolution of the fundamental underlying problems, but at the same time, there's been no escalation to conflict.
Are we seeing more disputes and increasing temperature in those disputes, if I can put it that way?
Well, we've seen a rise of dispute and activity in the South China Sea and, frankly, the East China Sea since 2009. I think this is going to continue to be a recurring pattern over the coming months and years. But the Chinese tactics right now of softening the line as well, because once the Philippines back down, the Chinese then could back off as well as they go into regional diplomacy. And that's the ASEAN Regional Forum meeting that will bring the foreign ministers of not just the 10 Southeast Asian countries, including the Philippines, but also outside countries like China and the United States to, this year, Cambodia, next month, middle of July. And it will allow the Chinese to talk about how they're supporting a code of conduct with the ASEAN states.
ASEAN being the Association of Southeast Asian Nations. What do these disputes, do they tend to be about the same thing all the time?
No, these disputes are about different things. And when you have domestic politics at work in the case of China, with a consolidation of power challenge for Xi Jinping, who is meant to be taking over from Hu Jintao later this year, these are even more complex than just the sovereignty disputes over whose interpretation of an exclusive economic zone is accepted, whose historical claims to islands and drops of land is accepted. What is the mechanism that countries sign up to help resolve these disputes? And by the way, what about all of the U.S. military, Chinese military activity, and other military activity that's happening on the surface but also under the surface? Who controls what goes on there?
After China and Vietnam went to war in the 1970s, I gather the Chinese adopted a policy of quote-unquote peace with the neighbors, and they have always talked about their economic development being a peaceful rise or economic development for peaceful purposes. Do the episodes that we're talking about on this program now contradict, in your view, those assertions?
It doesn't contradict, but it does create increasing tension with the assertion that it's all about win-win situations. It's all about economic activity and cooperation. Indeed, when you go off to an international conference and hear Chinese officials talk, official talking points, they cite words that are so happy, you know, peaceful coexistence and cooperation and win-win, but they seldom focus on the harder side of the edge, the fact that there really are disagreements and there's no agreement on how to settle these disputes. And so these tensions will continue to persist for some time, not just with the Philippines, not just with Vietnam and China, but also with other countries in the region. In the entire region and the entire world has a lot to lose if there's not freedom of navigation and essentially stability in good order at sea in this critical body of water.
Now, last time you were here a few months ago, we asked you whether or not China's muscle flexing would result in its neighbors seeking closer ties to perhaps the United States as a kind of a counterweight to that. So let's follow up on that. Are the Philippines and the United States becoming closer as a result of what China and the Philippines have been going through?
We've seen the biggest strengthening of the U.S.-Philippine alliance since the heart of the Ferdinand Marcos period decades ago. This is a highly unusual reinvigoration of an alliance that had largely been moribund since the United States left Subic Bay Naval Base and Clark Air Base back in the early 1990s. And what we're seeing is a Philippine government under President Aquino and Foreign Minister Del Rosario very committed to building up Philippines' very limited coastal navy and air defense capabilities with the help of the United States, exercising with U.S. military, talking about international support for multilateral resolution of these issues. So it's been a very active Philippine government and a very active U.S.-Philippine alliance in the recent months.
Is that to say that the Americans have therefore adopted the Philippine position as it relates to the South China Sea?
It means that the United States wants to show the region that it is in Asia for the long term and that we're committed to continuing to provide a historic role that we've provided of balancing power, of providing stability and order, freedom of navigation, free access, free commerce. And we do that first and foremost through alliances. And now that the U.S.-Philippine alliance can be effective again, we're working very closely with Manila. But we don't adopt, the United States will not adopt, neither Republican nor Democratic administration, a carte blanche policy of saying, if you go out and instigate a conflict, we're with you. Instead, it's we want to provide Asian countries, and it's starting with our allies, the ability to resolve these disputes peacefully on their own terms. That means be able to see what's going on in the region with coastal radar, being able to patrol their waters with their own patrol boats, but also being able to cooperate with the United States and neighbors should there be a direct threat to Philippine sovereignty. Where the United States would definitely step in would be if there's an attack on Philippine citizens, the United States would step in and help because they are a treaty ally. But that's not taking a position on the disposition of any disputed islands or waters. That would still be left for the future to be resolved through some other means.
Okay, I understand that. And thankfully, we haven't seen anything that dramatic happen yet. But short of that, what has been and what are the plans for the United States in terms of their responses, you know, when disputes like this come up?
Again, the United States is working region-wide to try to build the capacity of the countries in the region to stand up to potential coercion and coercive means of resolving disputes against their interests and against their own sovereignty. So in Scarborough Shoal, China has historical claims to the islands, and that's why they're basing their position and their assertiveness on those historical claims, and there's a logic to that assertion. But the Philippines has the fact that these islands are within the 200 nautical mile exclusive economic zone of the Philippines. That's a very powerful argument, and there's reason why the Philippine argument should win the day. Without being able to resolve that through any independent, objective, international binding means, the United States, in the meantime, wants to encourage the Philippines to resolve this diplomatically, but not to be pushed around, not to be able to be coerced by China in this case. So that means building Philippine capacity. It means exercising with the Philippines. It means showing U.S. presence that we have a stake in stability. And finally, it means mobilizing the region, like the 10 Association of Southeast Asian Nations in Southeast Asia, to go to meetings like the ASEAN Regional Forum in Cambodia this July and talk about a code of conduct and a mechanism for resolving disputes that doesn't give the advantage to one powerful country like China, but rather gives the power really to a multilateral decision making.
Let me move, Patrick, in our last few minutes here to some discussion about Vietnam, because there's been a real change in the relationship lately between the U.S. and Vietnam. And let me read this from the Voice of America that was out earlier this month. In Hanoi's searing, hot mid-morning sunshine, defense chiefs of two nations, once at war, took part in a poignant exchange of war memorabilia, the diary of a Vietnamese soldier killed in action and letters written by an American officer serving in Vietnam. The symbolic gesture was part of Defense Secretary Leon Panetta's visit to the country following the annual Shangri-La Defense Dialogue in Singapore. Panetta's arrival in Vietnam Sunday marked a symbolic deepening of ties between the two when he became the highest-ranking American official since the war to visit Vietnam's commercial deepwater port, Cam Ranh Bay. Tell us why you believe the U.S. and Vietnam are forging these closer ties right now.
Vietnam wants to reach out to the United States to balance growing Chinese power. And the United States has a strong interest in working with new partners like Vietnam to help provide international rules of the road that can be withstand essentially coercive pressure from China. So there's a great interest in working closely with Vietnam. So that's starting with strategic dialogue, which has been growing really over the last decade, even 15 years of painstaking work since the roadmap to normalization with Vietnam was completed in the mid-90s. Now we're talking about exercises and even military port visits, again, even to Cam Ranh Bay. There wouldn't be any permanent stationing in Cam Ranh Bay anytime in the foreseeable future, but one could imagine more frequent visits to Cam Ranh Bay as U.S. ships pass through the region to signal American interest in stability. And Vietnam, meanwhile, knows red lines with China very well. So whereas the Philippines is sometimes said to perhaps be prone to miscalculation because any one government may be responsive to nationalism in the body politic, Vietnam has worked with China for such a long time. They know that they can push China so far, so they're not likely to invite the United States to do anything that would create antagonism with China.
Well, I was going to ask that. I mean, is China sort of sitting back and, I mean, are they okay with what's going on in this enhanced relationship?
I don't think China wants to see an enhancement of U.S. military position and U.S. influence in the region in general. And yet I can go back to the end of the Bush administration when State Counselor Dai Bing-guo told then Acting Secretary John Negroponte how they, China, did not want to push the United States out of the region. For the last 3 years, we've seen this growing assertiveness in the South China Sea and in the East China Sea, and it's starting to ask the question, you know, are the Chinese changing their view? Do they really want to see a diminution of U.S. power and influence? Would China really accept any basing on the Asian mainland, whether it's in Utapao, which is the Royal Thai Naval Air Station, where we're talking about setting up a humanitarian assistance hub? That's where we flew humanitarian assistance to Burma when it had its cyclone Nargis several years ago, or in Vietnam at Cam Ranh Bay, which has obviously a very historic deep water port that could be visited. Those mainland bases become even more sort of sensitive to Chinese strategic calculations over what is their sphere of influence and in their core interests. So those are harder than the maritime Southeast Asian relations that we have with countries like the Philippines and obviously outside of Southeast Asia and countries like Australia.
Patrick, thanks a lot for your analysis on this part of the world that is utterly fascinating but that we don't necessarily hear that much about or enough about. So appreciate your time very much.
My pleasure.
Patrick Cronin from the Center for a New American Security.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.